All right. So I hopefully Sophia will join us as we get started here, but I think we're going to go ahead and jump in, and I'm going to, I didn't think about gavel. We're going to call the Portsmouth School Board meeting to order for this sort of, I guess I should say, specially scheduled meeting on Monday night, March 30th. 2020. Steve, do you want to do the roll call?
Sure. Actually, I don't have a sheet in front of me, so I'm going to go by the pictures here. Kristen Jeffrey.
Here.
Hope Van Epps. Nancy Clayburg.
Here.
Pip Clues.
Here.
Argo Peabody.
Here.
Kimberly McGlinchey.
Here.
Tara Kennedy.
Here.
Ann Walker.
Here.
Jeff Landry, Brian French, not here. Correct? All right.
Correct.
That's it.
Excellent. Before we launch into our agenda, I did just want to touch on a couple just logistics things and obviously welcome everybody. We are incredibly grateful that we can be together right now as a board in the midst of everything. So thank you all for being open to meeting remotely and trying this out. And George and Steve and I were talking earlier today, we are the citywide, we're the first public board to meet in this fashion. So we're gonna be testing some things out. And hopefully that will be helpful for folks across the city, which should be great because given the longevity of this, we want to make sure we can continue to meet and have opportunities to touch base along the way, of course, on the school side. So very briefly, this is a recorded meeting. So we're going to, there will be an opportunity for the public to watch it as they normally could afterwards. We have our mute and unmute, functions here, and we're asking that everybody stay muted just because of feedback and, so we're not kind of tripping over one another's voices. I am going to do my darndest to kind of, facilitate and call on folks as we typically do during our meeting. And if you just literally raise your hand, I know that's kind of awkward, but to indicate that you'd like to speak or ask a question, that would be awesome during our discussions with superintendents. I don't believe any of our board members are on conference call, so we don't even have to talk about that right now. Everyone's here on video. Thank you. You'll notice we don't have the chat enabled. We aren't going to have that function where we can type in and chat as you would in many of your other Zoom meetings. We want to make sure that we, maintain full transparency of our conversation. And so that won't be part of this. And you guys, as you noticed on the agenda, we have essentially one big topic, which is our remote learning update and obviously our response to COVID. We're gonna try to have this conversation in about an hour today. We want all of our questions answered. I don't wanna limit anybody's comments. That said, if there are things that we start to kind of dive more deeply into and we want to put it onto another meeting agenda, I'll try and facilitate us that way just so that from a recording capacity, and we had a few things we wanted to just kind of keep this in about 60 minutes and see how far we get here. And then, was there anything else? George, did I hit it all? I think that was everything. Oh, I'm going to unmute you. Go ahead. George, say it again.
No, I think we're good. We have the chat is off. We're recording right now. And I think that covers everything.
Excellent. For folks in public comment, I'm going to get to sort of a couple things on ground rules for public comment in a second. So And then, you know, I also just thank the group and the public in advance for, you know, your grace and understanding. This is going to be a little clunky as we get started, and we'll get better at it as we go. But, you know, everybody's obviously in their homes and in lots of different places. And if there's anything that people need to take care of or step out or whatever, we understand, and you will just let us know. All right. We are going to actually take a pass on the Pledge of Allegiance, just given our current setup. We will resume that when we are in person next. And I'm going to go ahead and move us straight to the acceptance of minutes for March 10th, our last regular meeting. Anne, can I get a motion?
So moved.
Great. And second by Nancy. Thank you. Oh, and I should have said too, I'll try and voice over our first and second motions here, Paulette, but break in if you did not get who it was and just let us know. Okay.
I will. Thanks.
Great. All right. So moving on to public comment. All right. This is our first time, folks. So we're going to give this a try. So I see a few, I think I see 1, 2, 3 non-board member names or iPhones up on the screen. So I'm just going to read through these and make sure I have everyone who's here. Meredith Gadd, Louise Dupre, and I see an iPhone with no name on the screen. Is there someone else out there that wanted to participate? I'm having trouble unmuting it, actually.
Same. That's what I'm trying to unmute our iPhone.
I see an iPhone and an iPad. Do you have the iPad too?
That's Nancy.
Nancy. The okay. iPhone.
I thought I just connected it.
No, you're good, Nancy. Don't worry.
You're fine. There is an iPhone that also I can't seem to unmute. It's possible they've decided to be muted, and now they're gone.
Might be gone. Okay, that's all right. We will, if they pop back on, we can ask if there's any last participants that want to speak. So Meredith and Louise, we obviously don't have our typical sign-in sheet here for this public comment. Do either of you want to speak at public comment?
I do not.
And is that you, Meredith?
That yeah, I'm all set too.
Oh, both of you. Okay, great. You're here just to observe the meeting?
Yes.
Yep. Yes.
Excellent. Thank you for being here. All right. Then with that, we're going to go ahead and move forward to our superintendent's report.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
We can.
All right. I had emailed you, the board members, an outline, but really this is a verbal report. I'll be primarily going from that outline to give you an update on where we are, where we have been, and where we think we're going with our remote learning here in Portsmouth. I guess I'd start by saying I don't think I've ever been prouder to work in this district with this group of people. You know, the response across the board from, you know, cafeteria workers to teachers to administrators has been remarkable in terms of what we've been faced with and how people have reacted to it. It wasn't, you know, believe it or not, wasn't that long ago. So March 16th was when we first started not having students in school. And, you know, as we made that call that weekend, while we had put it into the back of teachers' minds, certainly in the week or two prior, we really had no idea we were going to be moved this quickly into a remote learning plan. So teachers began planning in earnest on March 16th. On March 17th, the next day, we had the food service up and running. Again, great kudos to everybody that's been involved with that. I know Luis on this meeting has been a big part of that as well. Just a lot of people stepping up and helping out with the distribution of food for our students. I would say the vast majority of the takers of that program have been students who were on free and reduced lunch, although we did open it up to all students regardless of whether or not they were on free and reduced lunch, and made that available. You know, and we can get to the financials later. You know, there's a lot behind the scenes in some of this work where we're still hoping that we would get reimbursed for all meals we're given. But for right now, we're just giving out meals to anybody that that is requesting, and making note of our free and reduced lunch reimbursables. But as of today, it doesn't, there's no guarantee we'd be reimbursed for the other meals that we're providing. But again, that speaks to the work and the focus on equity that we've had in this district for a long time and trying to build that out. I will say from March 16th to today, the full administrative team has been meeting every day, first physically and then gradually into our Zoom worlds. So now we Zoom every day still, first thing. And equity is, again, always on the front of the mind of the administrative team. Both in how we're structuring this remote learning, but also how we're trying to get to students who we have concerns about in terms of access or in terms of keeping hold. One thing I didn't put in the outline, but a big shout out to George. A big piece of this has been making sure we have technology accessible to all students. And so George had purchased a large number of hotspots, and he's been delivering them. I think the Portsmouth police have taken notice because he usually has a bunch of them in the back of his car, and he ends up meeting people in odd places and delivering hotspots. So in case that ever shows up in the police log, it's all legit. But there's been a lot of work to get access to all students. So on March 18th, 2 days later, we did start rolling out our remote learning process with students. And it was a gradual rollout. Not every classroom and teacher was ready on that Wednesday. But we did a gradual rollout through the end of that week. And the first week that we really got into play was really focused on how do we get students engaged. We weren't trying to push out a whole lot of content. We weren't, you know, trying to, you know, make sure that everybody had their quizzes and tests or anything like that. We first wanted to make sure we could make a connection with students in this new world. So a lot of it was about how do you do a Zoom meeting, or how do you access Google Classroom or some of those things. And again, I would say we were very well positioned because a lot of teachers were already doing that work in terms of Google Classroom and other tools. And one of the sort of the side benefits, I would say, of all of this has been really the collaboration that we've seen teachers do, where teachers who have these things set up are reaching out and helping teachers who don't. And again, this past Friday is one example, but we really have that as an ongoing culture in the district of teachers helping each other out. And as we've gotten into a few days of the remote learning environment, of course, a lot of things, you know, have to be rethought. And one of the big areas that we've been and continue to grapple with is around special education, where students have IEPs. Many of those IEPs have services that are certainly best delivered, if not have to be delivered in person. And that's been a challenge for us. And we know that it's a challenge that every district is facing. And so we continue to get guidance around how we can best structure that, how we can best position remote access for some of those services. But first and foremost, we want to make sure all students have access to the general curriculum. And so making sure that all of our students, including special education, et cetera, considerations, they have access to all of the material that we're delivering in the classrooms. So take that on to week two. Week two was really about calibrating some of the work expectations. That's something that we continue to do. One of the benefits of the Wednesdays that we'll get to in a moment will be around teachers being able to collaborate around their expectations and making sure that we can continue to calibrate those things. We know there's a huge need for teacher support. I think everybody jumped in. But what we heard after a few days was, wow, this is such a whole new world. I mean, it was like drinking from a fire hose, I think, for a large number of our staff, and just trying to come up to speed with new delivery systems, new ways of reaching out for students and things like that. And so that's been an ongoing process. Set aside how you look at your curriculum perhaps a little differently in this environment, because it's not delivered in the same fashion as you were delivering it before. And so we know there's a critical need for teacher support through this. Again, many of our teachers have stepped up, our librarians, our tech integrators, and staff among us who have an expertise in areas have been willingly sharing them. And there's been a lot of great work going on with that. I would say that there's been some real bright spots as we got into week two and into even into this week. We're starting to see a lot more videos of that are really for no other purpose, I would say, than to boost morale. So I know the high school students, a shout out to Sarah Mundy, our art teacher at the high school, put together a video of high school students sharing some reflections with teachers. And I know teachers reciprocated and created a couple of videos that went out to high school students. All of our principals are also reaching out in direct ways and making video chats and other things available. So there's a lot of effort to try to stay connected and not just a screen way, but a personal way that people are doing. I would say, again, the administration, as we continue to meet daily, I would also call out that the building level administration does that daily now also with staff. And I know when we meet with administrators, I think we've all been, you know, I don't know what our average number of Zoom meetings is a day, but I do know that principals and assistant principals are constantly reaching out and trying to help staff navigate all of the things that they're navigating. In the week two, and again, I just did this chronologically, but also something that popped up for us in week two as this settled in, was some of the ways this could affect the budget. We did have some conversations. Nathan's been a key player in helping us look through some of the budget considerations. One of the things has been around our vendor contracts. And so whether we're talking about special education services that we contract out for or transportation, those are our biggest areas. Jeanette Souther had gone through every single contract in the world of special education and either to look at whether it was still appropriate, whether we could, ideally we want to keep those services going in whatever remote fashion we can. But in some cases where, you know, where a school is literally shut down and those services can't be supplied, that we do need to go back and establish our expectations for what payment would be on those contracts. The same goes true with our bus company. We're in the process of sort of coming back to the table with them. As you know, our larger bus company, we still use for our food delivery. And so that certainly has been a huge help to us. And we certainly will be continuing to have an agreement with them to do that and make sure drivers are paid, et cetera. But yet we don't have the full level of service in our bus service right now. So we're looking at adjustments and payments to accommodate for the level of service that we have. And then quickly bringing us up to this week, week three in remote learning. As you know, end of last week, because we wanted to give parents some notice, we did shift to a 4-day instructional week, which I think has led to a little bit of confusion, I know. We still wanted to have 5 days of engagement for students. So we really want to make sure that they have either work to do or activities they can be engaged in for 5 days out of the week. And yet we know there's this critical need for teachers to have support, for teachers to have planning, for teachers to have time to collaborate across the grade level or across the building. And so that Wednesday day, we're trying to put together plans that will roll out next Wednesday, plans that would really involve a host of activities students can be engaged in. This is most, I think it's clearest at the elementary level because Unified Arts come once a week anyway. So really talking about holding Wednesday sacred for our Unified Arts teachers to provide some enrichment programming. And really we're trying to think of the more therapeutic side of the arts and some of those other areas. How could we use these to leverage an element of wellness with students, whether we're talking about yoga or other things. I think people are starting to now put together some creative ideas for what those Wednesdays could look like. But that being said, we're not talking about shifting high school schedules for what students have for classes. And so students will still have their full slate of classes. And on those Wednesdays, say for a typical high schooler, they may very well have work that has to be done in their math class. It's just that it's a project or something they're doing. So, in those cases, those enrichment activities are really more of an invitation for students who can make themselves available to them. I would also note that this week we are in the middle of our second distribution of elementary materials, and that is happening at different points in the next week among the three elementary schools where they will still, again, coordinate a curbside pickup of materials for elementary students. That seemed to go very well. Again, in the proper safety protocols in place on that curbside pickup. And I'm sure this week will be even more so than last time. Just a real, real morale booster to see the faces of teachers here and see students. So those will be happening over the next few days. As we go forward, just some future considerations. We also stay in regular touch with the Department of Education. We meet 3 times a week. We also are in regular touch with the city and where we are in terms of city policies around COVID. Right now, as you're aware, May 4th, is projected to be the return to school date. I'm sure that will be totally dependent on what happens in the next few weeks. And so we're doing a lot of contingency planning right now with administrators and looking at, well, the what if we come back and the what if we don't come back scenarios, and just trying to play out the logistics of what we need to prepare for those options. One thing that had come up as a question, and I know a lot of districts are considering this, is the April vacation and whether or not, since we can't come back before the end of that, and since there'll be a stay-at-home order in place through that, does it make sense to just keep our remote learning activities going through April vacation and take those days off the back end, let students out a little earlier in June? I would say I did have a conversation with SAU 50 Superintendent Sal Petrilia today. They have the same questions in mind. They're going through the same process. Typically, we try to work with SAU 50 when it comes to calendar coordination. You know, although in this case, if we're all in remote learning, we're not dealing with bus schedules and whatnot anyway. Related to that, I would say the city has put out a policy to all city employees, and this would also cover school employees, that if anyone is to travel to any large metropolitan area outside of the state, or travel by plane or by train or bus, when they come back and return to Portsmouth, they will be asked to quarantine for 14 days. So that's a policy that will be in place through April vacation. And so we'll want to make sure that people are aware of that. And again, one of the April vacation considerations would be if we're in this scenario where by mid-April things are looking okay, but we're still operating under that policy, we don't want to see people go away on April vacation somewhere else, only to come back and have to miss the first 14 days of actual in school when they finally want to get back to school. Whether or not that's a policy we would want to enforce with all families, I think is a question, and I wanted to raise it to you to get your reaction to it, because we haven't yet messaged that out to families. But if we're to stay consistent with the city policy, we could consider messaging out to families that if you are planning to go away anywhere during April vacation, and we are coming back right after April vacation, your students may not, we may recommend your students not come back for those first 2 weeks. And so that's a big question, I know. I know, you know, as we get through this, we will continue to talk about plans when we do return. We know that students, and I will just say again, teachers are doing so much work. It's just amazing to see how much outreach is going on, how much effort is going on for people to reach the students who are hard to reach, the students who we fear are, you know, in danger of getting lost in this. There's a lot of outreach that's going on, a lot of knocking on doors, a lot of going to neighborhoods, a lot of phone calls, a lot of emails. But we do know people will come back and students will come back in different places from this. And so while we haven't gotten to detail planning yet, we know that we'll want to talk about something, and whether we're talking about summer experiences for students or whatever, a plan for remediation for students who may have not made as much progress in this remote learning period. That does have some relation also to what is typically considered extended school year programming in special education. That is something we do every summer. We would anticipate perhaps this summer, if we were offering that, we may be expanding that in the world of special education, those extended year services. And all of that may be to say that there could be some FY21 budget implications to all of this. Of course, our fiscal year turns over on July 1st. And so while none of this potential additional programming is currently contemplated in the FY21 budget, we know there could be an implication there. We are currently operating under a budget freeze. The city manager has put on a citywide budget freeze, and that would affect any non-essential expenditure. We have already made the step with school administrators and staff to say, we're fine to process orders that deal with what we absolutely need for remote learning. We'll prioritize anything we need to do that. But in terms of additional purchases, which we would just make to have, we're not doing those right now under this budget freeze. And part of that is to see where we end up landing from a FY20 budget perspective when the dust settles here. We know there are some areas we're actually going to be saving money, and we know there's maybe some areas where we actually have to spend more. And the last thing I would say, and it relates to money, is one of the things, words we got from the Department of Education, is as part of the large amount of stimulus money that's being generated now out to the country, is a school stimulus, school aid, that will come to each state and be distributed via the current Title I formula, although it will not be Title I money. It won't be restricted by Title I restrictions. But we'll essentially, what we were told is we could estimate getting somewhere in the neighborhood of about 80% of what we typically get for Title I money. And that money could be used for a variety of purposes, including potential remediation or summer kind of programming. So we do have some capability that we don't have that in hand yet. We don't have the firm number yet. We'll keep you updated, but there could be some assistance and aid coming that can help with some of the areas we know we will need it. I guess I'd pause there to see if George or Nathan wanted to add anything at this point.
I thought you covered it pretty well. I'll come in for Q&A where necessary.
All right, Nathan, I don't know if you have anything else to add. You're good. So thank you so much, Steve. That was great, and that was a lot. So I'm sure people have lots of questions jotted down. I'm thinking about how to organize conversation, but you know what? Let's just kind of open it up, and maybe we can be thoughtful about building off of what folks are asking about. So if we want to start with anybody can open it up, but go ahead, Margo, start us out, and then Nancy.
I have been asked by a lot of high school families who have kids next trimester that are starting a new course. What are the plans for that? Is that new course going to start? How are they going to get materials? Have we thought about that since that new trimester was supposed to start? I think that the current trimester ends this Friday. So there's some anxiety around that, what the plan is. So just thought I'd throw it out there.
Yeah, no, we appreciate it. And George can help out with this. We've both been in meetings with the high school administration quite a bit lately on this topic. So first of all, right now, generally the fourth quarter courses will run as scheduled. There are a number of questions about whether we shift grading practices and whatnot, but the student schedules will remain the same. And materials where needed would be distributed via similar methods that the elementary schools are doing. So there are some courses that would be material based. And I'd also say the change in quarter, just like elementary teachers need to access the building in places now, the high school teachers over the next week will need to do the same for some of these courses that are going to roll over. We do that under guidance of 10 or fewer people accessing a building at once and following a lot of protocols to keep in place there. But right now, this high school schedule itself will stay the same. Okay.
Thanks.
All right. Nancy, go ahead.
I have a question about how the classes are being done via the computer. Is Zoom being used by teachers to communicate the lessons? Exactly how is it being done? I'm just not clear about how it is being done.
We have several media that we've taught teachers with. Zoom is sort of our anchor for recording, but there's other tools such as Screencastify and Screen-O-Matic are things that you can pre-record lessons and post. A lot of teachers are using their own YouTube channel. They can record through one of these other mechanisms and post the file to a YouTube channel. So for the some of it is live interaction. Some of it is more of a flipped learning environment where the teacher is pre-recording their lesson and then they use the live classroom for a chance to confer with students and receive questions and have dialogues about it. But some content is pre-made. And there's a few different video platforms that we're using. We had a lot of training on them last Friday.
And the students are able to hook into these. Is there any student that I'm hoping there's no students that have gotten lost?
We've been tracking that, and each school has a system for that of, oh, this child hasn't logged on for 3 days, and the initial outreach is from the guidance department. And that's where we've been looking for, why is this child off mm-hmm. not checked in? Is it a technology issue? And if so, we try and fill that gap, or is it some other obstacle? So each school has a pretty clear mechanism for mm-hmm. Outreach to students who may not be engaged in the classroom.
And I know you said in the beginning in the communication that we got that all the students have a device that they can use, correct?
We think so. So we had an initial distribution of the high school devices actually the Friday before that we even canceled, just that Friday to be safe. We called down, granted all of our freshmen and sophomores already have Chromebooks. So this was juniors and seniors who needed a device. They all received devices that afternoon. And then the following week when we did the elementary students, we did Chromebook distributions to the elementary kids that didn't need it. That said, we're running into now just hit or miss things. You know, a child said they had a device at home, but oh, they got a little brother that needs their device at home. So we're going in and finding those pieces now, or they thought they could use their parents' computer, but now their parents working from home, they need the computer. We're just sort of whittling into the finer details with that, but I think we're getting everybody.
Great.
Thank you.
Hope, go ahead, and then Tara.
Okay. Also, I just wanted to echo, if I could, off of that for Nancy. I would say even before guidance steps in, my kids have even had their teachers reach out to them a lot, Nancy, when there's Zoom or Google Classroom issues. For example, my daughter had a problem and it turned out to be a technical and organizational classroom issue. So there is capacity for teachers to reach out even before guidance has to with the technology. I just wanted to ask the question regarding the 4-day instructional work week. I've heard from students, my own students, kids, as well as other students and parents have reached out to me about it being on a Wednesday midweek and cutting into the continuity of the work week, especially kind of looking at the high school level as they're really plugging in on Zoom. I know that PMS teachers are starting to, at least my kids, PMS students, have started to use more Zoom for instructional learning, and versus it being on like a Friday where projects could be rolled over for that Friday, or work can be done, especially with, I understand what Steve is saying about PHS students not necessarily it being mandatory, because if they have math, they continue with math, but if it interrupts, just kind of the continuity of the instructional work week for the students. And I will say, maybe there is a little confusion about right now when it's starting, because I know my students have already received some Zooms for Wednesdays for their teachers so there seems to be a little inconsistency in the messaging sometimes about what's being done and then how that's playing out. So, I don't know if we can address some of those. And then I wanted to ask too, if we could park it, Kristen, somewhere in the conversation, but I know some schools have also discussed, and we've seen some emails about pass-fail. I'd like to know where, from Steve or George, where you guys, I haven't heard that much positive feedback on pass-fail, to be honest, but I'd like to know where you guys kind of stand on that right now.
Yeah, so just to start with the Wednesdays, this was a conversation we went back and forth a little bit on. Some of the rationale behind the Wednesdays, probably first and foremost, we have a pretty significant concern about some kids falling off the grid in situations, home situations that we have concern about. And our administrators felt that having a 3-day weekend wasn't the best idea for not being able to touch base with kids as frequently as we would like. And the other piece was really in terms of the cadence of delivering some of this, is to have the 2 days for the remote learning, take that Wednesday pause, and then essentially plan in 2-day chunks seemed to be a little more manageable. But yeah, I don't think there's a huge advantage to saying Wednesdays beyond that. That's just the rationale we had behind doing that. I don't know, George, if you had anything else on that.
It was largely driven by wanting to have contact time without at-risk students, and folks thinking that 3 days with no contact was not a great situation. So
yeah, and then on the pass/fail, this is a conversation that that we're having. We had a lengthy conversation, a few of them today, with high school staff and administrators. And first and foremost, we wanted to sort of iron out what third quarter grading will look like, because we left that quarter in the middle. And so we have going out some of the guidance to staff and to families in the next day or so about that. And essentially what we don't want to do is have kids get harmed unintentionally by some struggles they've had to connect in this environment. And so rather than, the question had come up, well, I don't see the work product from some kids, they're getting a lot of incompletes or zeros. What we've said is if we need to extend time for kids, if we need to give them time to complete things, we would, we wouldn't. We don't want any policies that hammer kids with zeros for things right now in this period. And so we don't want to say, hey, this student had a B on March 13th and now they got a D, or they don't have D's anymore, but they have a C or worse. And really, have that be also an equity issue. So right now we're looking at finishing out third quarter grading as we have grades, and then looking at ways to make sure we can support students in finishing the competencies for those courses. Fourth quarter, right now, we don't have a firm decision on that. I know that has come up as a pass/fail. There's some pros and cons to it. One of the things I would also say we're getting from the DOE, as well as our own college counselor, Brittany Sullivan, who's been in contact with a lot of colleges over the last couple of weeks to really find out from them, how is this new shift going to affect students applying to college? The good news is the colleges understand that this is where every high school almost in America is right now. I think they're going to see a lot of pass/fail kind of grading systems, but we haven't chosen to go that route at this point, Hope. We'll keep you updated, though, because that is the next jumping in conversation pretty quickly with the high school staff. The fourth quarter doesn't start until April 8th. That's the Wednesday, because typically we'd have a couple days of exams. That's just going to be extension of third quarter. So really we have it till April 8th to iron some of those things out.
We're actively meeting with staff about this, though. It's funny, two things you brought up today, we talked about today, and we're trying to iron out. There's a lot of detail to grading, especially at the high school, and scenarios, and we're trying to come up with a balanced system that recognizes some of the hardships that kids are undergoing now, but also doesn't disincentivize the kids that are sort of maintaining their status quo. And so finding that sweet spot is something we're trying to be really thoughtful about.
I wonder if it'd be worth a note to just from Mary in the weekly email to say, we're thinking about it, or I don't know if she already has, but just call out some of these bullets, even if there's no answers, but to say the conversation is happening so folks know that it doesn't merit discussion right now, but just as a,
Yeah, we can do that.
If we haven't already called something out, we know folks are thinking and wondering about it, might be helpful.
And I think something finalized will be out by the in final form will be by the end of the week too. So
wow. Okay.
Yeah.
I forget that a day in this new world is like a month and a half. So that's great. Tara, I saw your hand, and then I'm sorry, back to Margo. Go ahead, Tara. Oh, I'm sorry, hon. Go ahead.
Okay. So back to the, I think you had mentioned lost track of students. I think like it makes sense that you notice the lost students that aren't showing up and aren't showing up in the Zoom meetings, aren't handing in their things. I'm assuming that that's coordinated with the counselors, but what about like the usual day-to-day eyes that all the teachers, the counselors, the staff at the schools all have on all the kids in the school? What are we doing to like maintain that like connectivity and eyes? Because in terms of like how all these kids are doing, like the hidden problems, and is there anything that we can do? Are there people connecting elsewhere?
I would just say that, yeah, our counselors and support staff are really reaching out to kids actively. I think the reason we've had we've had no issue with staff, like we've had tons of staff volunteering for food delivery. And I think it's just to put eyes. Like, I think it's really that when you see all these videos made by the kids and the videos made by the teachers, and I've seen videos of a couple, like I saw a kindergarten birthday party out of Dondero. I mean, there's just such a need to see each other and connect with each other right now, in large group. But also I think those people that are connected to kids in one-on-one type counseling situations, they're really seeking them and finding them with a high rate of success.
Okay, thank you.
Margo.
Okay, sorry, I got muted.
Sorry.
Okay, responding to a couple things. I do sense there's some anxiety about the sudden change to the Wednesday off, and I wonder whether we should just lead with, because I do think people are unclear on, now they've finally built some momentum on schedule and routines. I wonder whether we get ahead of it by suggesting what that Wednesday looks like. So I hear from a high school perspective, it sounded like, Steve, you were saying it's pretty much a similar day, particularly if you're a student that's not in any unified arts classes. So I wonder whether at each level, to more parent angst probably than student angst, is how do we keep this ball that we've started to get rolling and systems are in place going forward on Wednesday? That might be a nice thing to add, because I think our communication has been really great. And I think the more we can get ahead and engage with where the emotions are for the kids and the parents, that might help. So that was also my follow-up on that with what Tara was asking. I've started to see at the middle school and the lower school level, which are not having their classes taught by Zoom as much as they are at the high school level, that their social groups are reaching out and having FaceTime and Zoom sessions. And I think that's something that we could send out as an encouragement. Is your child feeling lonely or miss their buddies? Here are some ways they can connect with them. I wonder whether that's another way. And then to roll on to that, the third thing was, it sounds like from the high school level, those kids whose classes are meeting at their normal time on Zoom, that is a predictability and a consistency that they are loving. And those that aren't having that are feeling a little lost in the shuffle. And I wonder whether there's talk about, is that the goal to get there at the high school level? I'll stop there.
Yeah, I just start with the Wednesday message, I would say, was a little tricky to message K-12, just because it is going to look a little different at each level. Right. But we've been working with each principal, and again, this has been our topic of conversation, is how do we now make sure each building is really messaging clearly what that's going to look like, right, for kids there. And so, and then to your point about that, you know, how do we expand the practice and consistency? I think that is why these Wednesdays are going to be so important for staff, is to really start to talk about what's working and how do we expand it. We still may have weeks of this. And so it's really important that we start to develop these practices quickly to develop more and more of that consistency.
Great.
Oh goodness, did I say someone after? I think it was Tara, Kim, Sophie, Hope. Go ahead.
I just raised my hand, but I didn't realize that they were doing the classes at the high school because I don't have one there, but I didn't realize they were doing those daily. I know they're doing them. They just started at the elementary school. I don't see them personally at the middle school, but I agree that it's helpful to have not just the regular checking in and the, hey, do you want to join my Zoom for extra help, but having the class. And again, I know this is changing daily and weekly, but will that be part of the middle school as well, since we're seeing it in the elementary and high school? Like the classes that you have to join like every once in a while.
So I don't think it's that way at the elementary right now. I think some they are scheduling some morning meetings and other pieces like that, that are some synchronous types of activities. And I think the middle school is as well. I think at the high school, the tricky thing while we had to go that way was to avoid scheduling conflicts. We were really high school was really worried about students having conflicting engagements. So I don't know, Steve, if you want to add to that at all.
No, I would just say, you know, one of the tricky things in all of this is how do you transition as a teacher into this environment? Mm-hmm. And one of the challenges, and you know, it's funny, we were having this back and forth conversation with some teachers last week, because some would say in this environment, you want a more of an asynchronous approach. You want to have access whenever kids happen to be available. And yet teachers operate on a very synchronous schedule where you have your 20 kids at 11:30 or whenever. And so one of the challenges I think for teachers, and maybe Kim could speak to this, but has been around, how do you create that classroom environment online? And Zoom has been very helpful in a lot of that. But again, there are some limits to how we can just sort of make that classroom shift online with a Zoom setting. I think it works really well in some classes. I personally have listened to a lot of pre-cal lessons in the room next door over the last week, but it doesn't work with everything. Kim?
Yeah, go ahead, Kim. You can, and then Sophia, we'll get back to you.
So I wanted to go back to Tara in terms of how are we helping students not kind of disappear into the ether. And what I want to say is our students are helping students. So I do Zoom with my students every day, and I think they really look forward to it. I know I look forward to it. It's pretty interesting because at first, students would just have their initial, they didn't want any part of us, you know, seeing anything, which is 100% perfect. But more and more people started to video engage. And what we do a lot of the times is, you know, I'll take attendance, who's here today, and if we're missing students and we haven't seen them, I'll be like, hey, does anyone know where so-and-so is? Can you shoot them a quick text? And sure enough, oh, they can't get on right now. There's a problem, and I'll shoot them another invitation. So the students helping students, Tara, to your point, is really, really stupendous. Our students have a really small, really great community. And they're able to connect with each other and pull people in. And Sophia can maybe talk a little bit about that. But we do meet every day. I have, you know, I've always had a syllabus. So they get my syllabus. They get a table of what we're doing this week, when it's due. I mentioned earlier I was trying to cut back on screen time a little bit because I feel like they said at first they were spending 6 to 8 hours on the screen a day. And those Chromebooks have a really small screen. And then I know that the teachers and ourselves were also spending an additional 12, 14 hours trying to keep track of assignments. So I will say that the screen time issue could be a problem, but trying to give kids things that aren't necessarily on the screen seems to work pretty well too. So being creative about that and just figuring out that balance has been really important. But our high school students, you know, they're in a different group than the middle schoolers, but they are looking out for each other. And I think that's awesome. So that's pretty much what I wanted to comment on.
That's great. Thank you. Sophia, go ahead. If you'd like to share.
So first of all, just to talk a little bit about, like, from like a student perspective, like the experience for me right now. So only one of my classes has like a everyday Zoom call. So that's with my calculus teacher, Mr. Lyford. And something that's working with that is that obviously there's so much more time during the day that, like, if we do have that Zoom call in the morning and later in the day we have like a question, you can just, he has like office hours that we can join into, which is really great. That I'm not sure if all teachers do that, but I think that's really helpful. And then also, what else did I say? Oh, and another thing that Lyford specifically has done that I thought just like made me feel a lot better about this whole thing, and kind of like, it was just kind of a like comforting thing that I think that a lot of teachers should try to do too, is he made like a Google form or like quiz thing that you could fill out, and it was just saying like, how are you doing, what's something that's like changed for you, what's something that's like good about this, bad about this, like what can I do to help you, what can I do for the class. And I think that that just like knowing that he wants to like listen to all of this is really, really helpful. And then this is, so I had some friends like give me any questions they had for this meeting. And obviously as a senior, one of the things that a lot of people are really nervous about is graduation. And I know that that's kind of like farther down on our list, and like, you know, it's, we're hoping that we'll be back by then, but that is something that I know a lot of people want to just like hear something about.
Thank you, Sophie. Do you want to speak to that, George or Steve, kind of the latest thinking?
Yeah, so the latest thinking is certainly keeping an element of hope that we are back after April vacation. We're going to have actual prom, actual graduation, everything. And that would still be our ideal. But we'll know more in a few weeks to where we stand with some of those things. You know, the plan B, and this is, you know, certainly it does affect the seniors, but plan B is how do we get creative and do as much celebrating as we can to honor the work that these kids have done through their years here, which again, we'll probably put out a whole host of requests for some ideas of what could be really neat for that. But yeah, we would love to see graduation still happen. It still would be scheduled for June 5th. That would not change in terms of the date. If you recall, we had a good number of days in between graduation and when everybody else was going to get out later in June. Mm-hmm. But we would probably see that date where everybody else was getting out move closer to graduation. So right now it may be 10 days after graduation, whereas in the new schedule, if we go through April vacation, maybe it's only 5 days after graduation.
Gotcha.
Thank you. All right. Hope, did you want to chime in?
I did want to piggyback on a couple of things, but then if everyone's done with this topic, I did have a couple of questions I wanted to move into regarding return date and April vacation. So I don't know if that would be okay to move on or if people have other questions. But just in piggyback, since I have two middle schoolers and a high schooler, I will just say that there is significant difference, as there should be, in how things are somewhat, the continuity that you're seeing in instruction. Zoom is obviously being used a lot. I think from the high school level, it is very helpful that they're moving through the day from a block perspective. And even my middle schoolers have commented that that could be harder in middle school, but it also can be helpful. I think as to piggyback on what Margo was saying, it will be helpful for us to be thoughtful about change and how much change is coming about week to week, because the middle school did just make the change, at least a lot of teachers did. I'm not sure if it's across the board, but to provide all the work up front for the week and assignments, and then that gets broken down by students throughout the week, which can be pros and cons depending on a student learner. I think one of the things, so that was just a change, and now we're adding the Wednesdays, and I understand why we need to add the Wednesdays, but I think just as we're adding changes, to be really thoughtful about checking in with the teachers and seeing what they may be doing for changes at their level that we're not maybe even aware of at a higher level. Because I know each teacher, they're doing a little something different for their classes. I will say that I think one of the biggest challenges is there seems to be more teachers at the high school that are more technically savvy to some degree with some of the equipment that's being used for Zoom. Not all of them. I know my son even has a teacher that thought she's retiring and she thought she was going to escape with never using any of this. So I know it's not the situation for all, but I do think the Wednesday trainings will help be able to kind of bring along the middle school teachers a little bit more. I'm seeing them start it for instructional purposes. So just for whatever that feedback is worth, I think it's interesting.
Are you guys all freezing up, or is this
just
hope?
It's hope.
Okay. Hopefully she will come back here in a second. I guess in terms of just the individual, you know, we know there's going to be variants. I know that's something, you know, everyone is working very hard on across the schools. And a shout out just, I guess, from the public side is please, fill out the surveys. I know the middle school parents, we just got a survey. I think there were surveys going out across the district to parents. So that would be a great way to just feed into this conversation. And I know you guys are going to be tweaking things as we go here. So any last comment? Oh, Kim, did you have one last comment on the instructional side? And then I would love to talk about the
April. Yep, just quickly to Sophia. The teachers have a working doc where we have a variety of questions that we put down. And then Mrs. Lyons or someone responds to those questions. So I'm wondering if you might want to start something like that, and I don't know if it would be okay, but a working doc where you get these lists of questions from your peers, and we could let students know we had this working doc, and then Mrs. Lyons or George or Steve or someone could respond to their questions, because it's just a running list, and they respond in red, and then everyone can see them. So I don't know if you want to take that on. I know you're busy.
Yeah, no, definitely. That sounds great. And then maybe I could just talk to you after about how to like send that out to the whole. I wonder if it would be better. Do you think it'd be better to have four separate ones so that like there could be more manageable amongst like the grades, or if there should just be one for the whole school that I just send out? I can do either, but.
I'm thinking one for the whole school, but then again, I don't know. Anybody else have an opinion on that?
I would also say a survey just did go out to all PHS students. And so maybe, and Sophia, I'm sure Ms. Lyons would be happy to share that with you as well. But I would say the more feedback we can get from students, the better.
Okay, I'll work on that today.
That's great. Thank you, Sophia.
Because like little things like, asking students, like I know I asked my students and they love having all their assignments due on say the Friday, April 3rd, and they can pace themselves. So someone else just mentioned that. So it's good to hear how they like to organize their time just instead of having a lot of things being due and juggling everything.
Well, across the schools, let's definitely encourage folks to complete those surveys. Tara, do you mind if I take us to this question around, because Steve, I don't know if you posed this kind of directly for discussion tonight, in terms of the April break and 14-day kind of quarantine question. I'll just throw out there that I think my personal opinion is that we need to stay as consistent as possible with the city and kind of the guidelines that are, you know, coming at us from that perspective feels really comfortable, certainly from the travel piece of it. And yeah, and if that, I think there's a whole lot of reasons it makes sense to keep going in April, frankly, and just keep moving, and then figure out what the right date is on the back end. So I see Tara and then Anne. Go ahead.
Yeah, that's actually what I was going to move into with my last hand raise. So I agree about staying consistent with the city. I think it's important just to maintain that overall right now, for many reasons, maintain that consistency and collaboration. In terms of the April break, I agree as well personally that we should just skip that and continue on. But my question is I've gotten a couple comments from parents and teachers, and I was wondering, I've only heard a couple, so the teachers were all for it. A couple parents just had concerns about their kids, like if it would affect their fifth graders graduating and all that. I think e-school was a concern, but we know personally at New Franklin, we know that's not happening anyway. But what responses have you gotten? And I guess I'm more concerned with the teachers, like, or is that a pro, a con? And that's it.
Yeah, we haven't canvassed everybody yet. And I did talk to Erin Bockham, and that is something that she may take on to get further feedback from teachers. And of course, we'll want to pay attention to that too. One of the things we felt was, you know, letting this schedule, now that we'll be in it for a while, with the 4-day week, sink in, how manageable does that feel? There is no doubt that, you know, if you're asking this after 4 days in, everyone was saying we would be lucky if we make it to April break. I think that people are starting to get their feet under them a little bit more, and there's a lot more supports that we're putting in place for teachers. So I'm not surprised that more and more are feeling this way. I think generally that's what I've been feeling. The only oddly, you know, in talking to other districts about this, the loudest voice I can hear of people who would want April break is actually from administrators in the districts I'm talking to. I'm not speaking locally necessarily, but I do think that, you know, this is definitely an adjustment. It's been an adjustment. But I think generally as we get into it, and if we're under the same restrictions at the end of April as it looks like we'll be, I would agree. It definitely is something worth considering.
Go ahead, Anne.
First of all, I really have liked hearing everybody talking about their own kids and their experiences and what's actually happening with not having kids in school. This is really helpful. And also hearing from Sophia and Kim. And my personal opinion is I really think we should push right through and skip April vacation and just keep, you know, once we get on the flow and everything going well, I think we should stick with it and stop earlier if that happens. So that's my opinion.
Thank you, Anne. Hope, go ahead.
I just wanted to say you would have my full support and pushing right through April vacation. I think it's almost a sense of responsibility when we listen to health officials talk about the risk of having somewhere that's been under kind of stay at home, mandatory or not mandatory. And then by announcing April vacation, it almost encourages people to have that freedom to go and travel, which does put communities at risk once you travel if you don't quarantine. for reoccurrence. So I definitely would say that the sooner we can make that decision and vote on it, and if we need to vote and get the word out, the better our community would be.
Thank you.
Pip, go ahead. I would also support that personally, for the reasons already stated, but I do have one question, I guess, which is, if people have plans that somehow they can still carry out for the time that they may have already planned before all of this has happened, how could we accommodate those people who might not be able to do school for that week? And would we ease up on some of the restrictions or scheduling or assignments that are due by them that week?
Yeah, that's a great question, Pip. And one of the benefits of this, and we haven't talked about this in detail at all yet, but is that we certainly are going to have the capability, we know, to help those students if they have to be quarantined to still access their education. We would cross that bridge when we come to it, but I think we certainly would keep those kids connected.
Great. Nancy, go ahead.
I just can't imagine that families would want to go away. It's not that far away, and it's within that May 4th time perimeter. I just can't imagine that families would go away based on the seriousness of this whole incident that we're in. So I would definitely be in favor of going right through April vacation.
Thank you, Nancy. Go ahead, Pip.
I also wanted to note that I did receive at least one message via email from a parent who was in support of this as well. I forgot to mention that.
I did too.
Yes, I did too.
Great. Other guests, Sophia, and then.
I guess this is another high school question. Some people were wondering about how we can go about, if you want to like switch a class or drop a class, is that still a possibility for students?
Good question.
That was also part of our meeting today, Sophia, with the high school. We had it with all department heads as well as guidance. There will be guidance about that soon, about especially in the case of seniors. Most of our classes are semester-long classes. What we're really talking about is the quarter-long classes here, and that's another one that I think there will be guidance out about by the end of the week.
Okay, thank you.
Hope, did you have a last? Hope, you're not unmuted.
I know we're all in hope that we get to go back and have graduation. I certainly hope that is the case. But have we been doing any discussion for a backup plan for, I know some universities have done online graduations or whatever. I just asked the question because I would hate for us to, you guys have been all over everything, Steve and George, so I can't imagine this hasn't come up. But I just would not want us to be in so hopes that we're definitely going back that we're scrambling to come up with something. I want to honor our students with that. And then I also wanted to know, for the return date, we closed actually before the governor made the announcement. He made the announcement the next day of closures. So what is really guiding our return date, if it's not a mandatory return date by the state, are we going to be really looking more towards the city manager and counselor for that guidance? How are you guys kind of guiding that date?
Yeah, that's a great question. First about graduation, we haven't gotten into the creative juices of that yet, Hope, but I will tell you, our goal would be to have the most creative virtual graduation that is at all possible. And I will just say, just a shout out to George. He's had a second career as an SNL script writer because he's tried to get a couple things with he and I out to staff too. But we will want to honor those seniors. It would be really tough on them, I know. And so I'd actually turn to them for their ideas for what we could do. In terms of of that, you know, we'll certainly try to do everything we can do. George, I don't know if you wanted to.
I was just going to say, I hate to say it, but you can do a much more personalized and individualized virtual graduation than the actual graduation itself, which tends to be a bit of a mob. So I'm not advocating for that, but I'm just saying there's a lot of room for an actual more personalized graduation.
But to your point, Hope, I think it would be worth getting a group of people to really start putting some ideas on paper and really start looking at that. We don't want it to be a rushed affair in May to come up with that. But your other question about when we would reopen, I would point out that a group of superintendents in Rockingham County last week, before the governor announced the extension, were seriously considering preempting that to say, hey, look, we know Rockingham County is the hardest hit county. We have no comfort level right now in being to open up next week. And so I think we would run into the same conversation, which is what makes the most sense for our context. If the governor announces schools will be back or could be back on May 4th, we'd still want to have a conversation of what makes the most sense for us.
Thank you. That makes me feel a little more comfortable. I know I've asked a lot of questions, but I would feel... I feel really down on myself if I did not take a moment to just give high praise to our student body and our teachers and our staff and our central office and the admins. And I mean, I am so impressed with our students. I know I see the postings and stuff. Everyone has their days in their house where we just can't handle it anymore. But overall, even my own children, I'm so proud of. For my children, I will just echo what they say, and that is their teachers are all over them in the capacity of just checking in with them as individuals and humans first before students and academics, and then they're all over that too. So I just feel very, very, very blessed to be such a part of a knit community where students and education are really a high priority. So I just want to say thank you to all of you guys for all your hard work.
Hear, hear. Thank you for saying that. Yes. Nancy, go ahead.
Hope, that was very eloquent. It was very articulate. And I'm glad you said that, because I was thinking that, but not having children myself in the system, I'm really proud of you for coming forth and saying that. So thank you very much.
All right. Anything else? Other burning questions? I know we have one other piece on our agenda, but I do want to make sure I guess the only other thing that I kind of came in thinking about, and you know, if it's appropriate, we have a meeting next Tuesday, kind of getting back on our regularly scheduled program here. So there won't be too much time before we can kind of continue with some of these topics. But I, when I think about just sort of liability and any sort of where we are with the world of special education and ensuring we're feeling really good about plans that have had to kind of move into place. And, you know, Steve, maybe this is for next week to do a little bit more of a progress to, you know, date on, have IEPs been amended? Like, what has I know there's been a ton of outreach and conversations, but where are we in terms of services being delivered?
Yeah, so we could certainly get into a lot more detail with that. I would say we are starting to get again, a little more guidance around some of those things. You know, IEPs are based on the needs of students, so they may not change, but how we deliver those services may have to, and that's been the tricky part. You know, I think that's something I could probably even get Beth Souther to be a part of our meeting one way or another next time, and we could start to dive into a lot more detail with those. I would say a lot of what we've been doing has been dealing with you know, the students who we know will struggle the most to accommodate in this remote environment, students who are in out-of-district placements that have closed or in other areas that we've had to try to mitigate some things. That's a very much a case-by-case kind of conversation, kid by kid. So, but yeah, I mean, if it's okay, I would defer that to that meeting when we could maybe even dive deeper.
That'd be great if we could, take a look or just hear a little bit more about that piece of it. And maybe also, and you have on here for future considerations, just, you know, what does that mean for the extended school year? And how would, you know, potentially students that aren't in special ed, but also maybe take advantage of some of those opportunities if need be. So, awesome. Are folks comfortable moving on from here? Thumbs up, head nod, yes.
I'm sorry, I just have one quick thing. Yep. I just wanted to ask, how are things being handled regarding like clubs and things outside of academics? Because I do know the student council has a 3-hour screen time Zoom scheduled for Saturday, and that just seems like a lot of, I don't know if that's because of bylaws or something, and I know their meetings usually run for 3 hours, but I just didn't know if we're keeping kind of a tabs on kids' screen time and such for clubs.
Yeah, I would suspect, Hope, we don't see a lot of student clubs happening right now. Student council might be a bit of an exception in some of that. Generally, we don't anticipate at this point having spring athletics and some of those kinds of things. Again, that can change in a few weeks. But yeah, I'm not familiar with the student council one so much. I suspect that's a bit more of an anomaly. We certainly do want to be sensitive to the amount of screen time kids have. I know some of the other clubs that might be more service oriented, maybe still going with some service activities in some fashion, but I don't think by and large we have a lot of clubs still operating.
Okay, great, thank you. I'm good.
Great. All right. Then I'm going to move us forward here to our new business and kind of the only other item for this evening, which is the consideration and approval of two sets of contracts. First, our teacher contracts, and second, the administrative contracts. Anne, did you, before we take a motion, Steve or George, since this is my first time bringing these to the meeting, is there any sort of broader framing you want to do on these contracts just to sort of explain?
Yeah, so we were happy to bring to you the slate first of teacher nominations, renominations for our staff for next year. It's well-timed, honestly. I know it's been said, but the amount of work teachers have been doing over this period is just phenomenal. Probably the most common phrase I hear from parents is just a whole new respect they have for teachers and what that work is. So a well-deserved slate of teachers to bring to you for nomination tonight.
Excellent. Thank you so much. So in that, I will go ahead and ask for a motion to consider and approve the teachers' contracts for this coming year.
So moved.
Excellent.
Second. Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Great. And secondly, we'll ask for a motion to accept the nominations for the administrative contracts.
Move to approve.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Excellent. Thank you so much. And yes, I would just echo that, from the teacher side, certainly, and for our administrative team as well, it goes without saying, both from our central office administrators and our building leaders. Thank you. Thank you so much for everything you're doing right now to keep these trains running and beyond. I know, I do. I feel like we need a virtual cheer or something at this point. All right.
Thank you all.
Before we wrap up, are there any kind of last committee items? There are a whole bunch of future board agenda items that Steve and I need to kind of sit down and sort out a bit over the course of the next couple meetings to see what we need to prioritize at this point. But I did want to make sure if there were any other things that people wanted to shout out or update us on that may have been going on. Nancy, did you have something?
No, I just had a question about the next meeting. Is it the 7th or the 14th?
It is next week, I believe, on the 7th. Is that correct?
Sort of actually, the next scheduled meeting would be the 14th.
Oh, I apologize. I was thinking that we had skipped one and down, but no, we had a 2-week hiatus there. It must have been.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. Thank you for clarifying, Nancy. So the 14th. And if there, you know, to the earlier point of, you know, it seems like time, we're in this strange sort of time bending, and 1 week feels a lot longer than 1 week these days. So if there are things that are cropping up earlier, Steve, it's been really helpful to get the updates via email. And while I don't know that you need to keep doing them, you know, every single day, even if there's, you know, every other day or just things that are cropping up, that's been tremendously helpful. So,
yeah, I'll stay in the habit of giving you something every day. Some of them may be lesser than others.
That's great. And we can, of course, you know, pull ad hoc conversations together if folks are hearing something, you know, just in small groups or what have you as need be right now. So, all right. Well, with that, you know, Steve opened the meeting with this. Hope was, thank you so much for kind of calling out all the people that have been making this happen. But again, you know, we're all so incredibly proud of the district and proud of the work that's been going on and the care that's being taken for our students right now. And kind of the ability to really change on a dime has been pretty unbelievable. So thank you, everyone. Thanks for bearing with our first Zoom board meeting. Everybody did great. We followed our directions and raised our hands. So I appreciate you all. And
good
I will
job for you, Kristen.
I will good job. Thank you. A motion to adjourn if there's one out there.
So move.
Thank you. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Great. Well, we will be in touch and talk to you all very soon. Thank you.
Thank
you.
Good night, everybody.
Bye. Good night.
Stay safe.
Good night. Be well.
Your mother's doing well.
I will. Thank you, Margo.
Thanks. Take care, Margo.
And hope your husband is doing better, too.
Thank you.
All right. Take care.